Hey, what's up everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we're gonna start a five-part video series. And I'm gonna try to keep them as brief as I can because I'm just excited. We got 1 week away from Venom coming out. Hopefully by the time this episode goes up, we're about 1 week away. And I wanted to cover something that we haven't really talked too much about. And it's a series that's been lingering and I've been talking about wanting to do it for a while, which is the Ravencroft miniseries by Frank Thierry. And so we're going to get into that today. We're going to talk about just episode one or issue one of the book. We're going to focus on that. And then we're going to do four more focusing on each issue. I don't have the digital code, so there won't be any codes given out in this one because I bought this book digitally when it was coming out and I've been waiting to cover it. And now that we're a week away from the movie coming out, I figured now's a good time because Ravencroft is a place that will be in the movie, obviously, and we've seen it in the trailers and stuff like that, so it's not really a spoiler or anything. Most people, we've been talking about Ravencroft throughout this. They showed in the trailer, like, you know, the big gate with the name on it and stuff. So I'm just excited that this is going to get its chance in these movies because I think Amazing Spider-Man, I don't remember if Ravencroft was in there. I think it was in one of those, you know, Andrew Garfield Spider-Man movies. And I think Dr. Kafka was also in one of those movies, but portrayed as a man instead of a woman. So in the comic books, Ashley Kafka first appeared in Spectacular Spider-Man issue 178, which hopefully I have up on screen there so you can see it. And that's also the first time Ravencroft is introduced. So it's really soon after, maybe like a year or so after Kraven's last hunt ended. And we got this series called The Child Within. It was like a 3 or 4 part story that focused on Vermin and him coming across this random little kid. And then he essentially kidnaps the kid, but not really. Like, you know, you find out that there's a little bit more going on there. Like he's, you know, Vermin himself is trying to find his way back to where he came from. And this little kid is also looking for his home. So he's like, yeah, I'll bring you home, little kid. And then it turns out they're actually going back to Vermin's home. And then Spider-Man has to come in and help out. And Vermin and some of these other, you know, characters that are in this book all are kind of connected to Ravencroft. So we have, you know, Ashley Kafka first appears in, you know, 178 of Spectacular Spider-Man and talks to Spider-Man about the type of people that, you know, she cares for and that she wants, you know, to bring back safely to her establishment. And Spider-Man's kind of like on the fence. You know, during this time, it was kind of a dark time for Spider-Man in the comic books. And he's not really sure what to do with Vermin, essentially, and how to handle the character. And so so that's kind of where the origins of Ravencroft is. And then we've covered the 3 one-shots not too long ago. And I'll put a link to that down below where we learned more about Ravencroft, kind of the history of it, how it tied into Dracula and some experiments that were going on there with Captain America, you know, before World War II and stuff. And there's been other things like, it, you know, tying it to Wolverine and Sabretooth and kind of the weapon programs in a way. And there's been a lot of cool connections that we've learned about over the years. And they've had a journal, you know, from one of the founders of Ravencroft. And obviously it even ties back even further than that to the origins of Ravencroft and its first inmate, which is a, you know, someone who's related to Cletus Cassidy, who goes all the way back, you know, to the pioneer days in a way, when, you know, first English settlers were coming to this country. So it's crazy, like now that we're getting all this stuff, because I guess at some point when they created Ravencroft, they thought we kind of need an Arkham Asylum for Marvel. And then no one really did too much with that afterwards. I mean, some in the 80s and or mostly the 90s, I guess, was Ravencroft. And then they didn't really do much with Ravencroft for a while, except for mentioning it. But then over the last couple of years, obviously, Frank Thierry and others and editors and stuff were like, we do have a Arkham Asylum in our universe. We have Ravencroft. Why aren't we using it more and getting more into the lore of it? And so they have been, and it's been a lot of fun. So for this one, we'll try to keep it brief from here on out and talk about the first issue of Ravencroft by Frank Thierry and Angel Unzueta, who's the artist on the book. And this book does look good. I like Angel's artwork a lot. And we have Jonas Ravencroft's journal, and we kind of get in some of the backstory and the setup of what happened, like a just a reminder of what happened in the 3 one-shots that came out recently. And again, I'll put a link to that down below if you want to check it out. And then now we see Misty Knight, who is talking to some government agency. We don't know who they are. They're kind of in the shadows, and they're telling her like, hey, we're going to send you into Ravencroft to work there and keep an eye on John Jameson. Make sure he doesn't turn into a man wolf. Make sure that this place is actually done properly this time. We hear the Kingpin's getting involved. We hear Norman Osborn's getting involved, and we just want people there we trust. So can you do this? So Misty's like, yes, I'll go in as a counselor. And so she's in there talking to Freak and Grizzly and some other villains and, you know, trying to rehabilitate them. And Grizzly's actually thinking about it. He's like, you know, I've had this whole life as a villain. I keep getting beat up. And now we live in a day of, you know, everyone has a cell phone. So now there's just footage of me getting the crap kicked out of me online and people laughing at me. and it's affecting me. And he's like, so I don't want that anymore. I don't want this life anymore. So I'm willing to, you know, go in and get rehabilitated and find a good part of me and maybe become a better person so I can leave Ravencroft as, you know, a better person, you know, and maybe someone who can contribute in a better way to society. So it's kind of neat that they're taking that approach, but other inmates don't like that. You know, some of the other inmates who like who they are and like the mischievous things and horrible things that they do, they don't like the idea of anyone being rehabilitated. So they kind of corner, you know, Grizzly in the shower and kind of beat him up. I think that happens later on, but so that's kind of the environment there, is that there's a couple people that want to get better and the rest is same old, and that's probably because Kingpin is in charge of this place as the mayor. He kind of helped get it rebuilt. He put Norman Osborn there, and he also has a board of directors who we haven't met yet. But then there's also Reed Richards, Mr. Fantastic, who has helped with the rebuilding of it to make it state-of-the-art so they can focus on just treating people and not abusing any inmates that come in. But again, this is all under the eye of Kingpin, so there's still some abuse going on. And same with Norman Osborn. And this is Norman before he gets turned into before his sins are taken away, so before he's kind of a good guy. So that hasn't happened yet. So obviously Norman and Misty butt heads a lot. You know, she doesn't like him or trust him. And why should she? He shouldn't be trusted at all. He's a monster. And meanwhile, you have D-Man there, which is kind of neat. My friend Gene loves D-Man. So D-Man's there as a security guard. So you get to see some of D-Man. I actually really like what they did with him in this series. I think Frank Thierry has like a soft spot for that character. And so I like what Frank did with him here. He's kind of a stand-up dude, a little bit of a butt kisser. So he's not fully altruistic or good, but he is trying. So I do like that. And that ties in with Grizzly and all that other stuff. But then also other inmates like Hyde and other characters that are there. So this is a cool peek at some of the, you know, criminally insane, I guess, for this universe. So you're seeing a lot of people who are, you know, on the verge of sanity, I guess, you know, or keeping it together, I should say. And so Misty does come in. She, you know, when D-Man's threatened by Hyde, she knocks, you know, Hyde out and takes him down and saves D-Man. But then there's also other elements going on. So we actually have someone watching all this happening in the shadows of Ravencroft, which just got rebuilt. But apparently there's a secret area underneath that was, you know, that's where Absolute Carnage took place. Some of it, when Carnage took over this facility, he had like an underground area. Well, apparently that was still mostly intact and got rebuilt without Reed Richards knowing about it. So it's still down there. Some of the original remains are there, but also some, you know, some of it got rebuilt as well. And there's some creatures running around down there, and they're keeping an eye on what's going on up above in the actual facility. And that's going to tie into Kingpin and why he got invested. Because I always wondered, why did he really get invested in this? Like, what is his gain by having, you know, kind of control over an insane asylum? Like, maybe he can get a couple criminals out back on the street, I guess. But why put the mayor job of his in jeopardy like that? It didn't make a lot of sense. We actually get to find out why, but we'll find out in the next issue. But there are creatures underground, and it looks like former experiments of Ravencroft that go back to those, you know, three one-shots we talked about before. And they are in the shadows waiting. And now that the place is rebuilt, they are putting their final plan into place. And it will involve Kingpin. But since Kingpin is tied to this and didn't really willingly want to be involved, as we're going to find out next issue, he's a little afraid because he's like, I don't think I'm as in control as I want to be. I think these creatures in the basement are. So he reveals his staff on the last page, and we have Taskmaster, Scorpion, Moonstone, Hobgoblin, and obviously Norman Osborn is there too. So that's his staff, and he's like, all right, I got some of the toughest enemies out there, former Thunderbolts members, former, you know, just mercenaries for hire, whoever I can get a hold of. This is my staff of directors. No one's going to know about them because I want them here literally to help me deal with this monster infestation in the basement who is starting to gain control over my psyche and, you know, possibly, you know, do something to this place that I don't want done. It'll make me look really bad as the mayor. So that's the setup of the book. That's where we're at the end of this first issue. And I'm really digging it. I actually really thought this was a solid setup. I like the art. I like the story. I've always liked Frank Thierry's writing. You know, so there's some times where I'm like, I'm not fully on board with some of the stuff he's written before, but I do like his approach to things. And I think he's really great with characters and really great with mysteries. And there is a mystery building of a cell, a specific cell, which we're going to learn more about in the next episode. But it's cell 616, which is cool because it's, you know, that's the Marvel Universe. They call that the Marvel Universe 616. So in the multiverse, the main comic universe is Earth 616, I guess. It's something that some editors didn't really want to ever stick, but it did stick. And so that's a cool reference they put in here. So there's a mysterious inmate in cell number 616, and we're going to talk more about them over the next few episodes. So definitely come back for more. And if you already know who it is, don't spoil it. We'll get there coming up very soon. So let me know what you thought of this. I like this first issue. I thought it was a great setup, and we got four more issues to go. I'm going to try to record all of them tonight, and I'll get these episodes up to you guys as soon as I can. Hopefully all five of them will go up before Venom Let There Be Carnage comes out here in the U.S., next Thursday. Hopefully by the time this video goes up, it'll be a week from today. So hopefully I'll get a video up per day for you regarding Ravencroft. And if I can squeeze in some episodes in between, I definitely will, including the next episode, actually, which will focus on Nick Spencer's Spider-Man run, because we got a lot of catching up to do there, and I found a fun way to do it and try to keep it short. So we'll do that in the next episode. So more comic videos for sure, and we'll get more into movie stuff as news comes up. But I'm trying to avoid some movie conversations because obviously I don't want to open the door for potential spoilers for you all. So I'm trying to keep it to comic books right now. But if something interesting pops up with the movie, I will definitely cover that for sure. So including a screening that will come up, and maybe I'll talk a little bit about that in the next episode. So thank you so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And I'll see you all in the future. Peace.